Notice of a public meeting of the City Commission of City of Brownsville. Pursuant to Chapter 551, Title V of the Texas Government Code, the Texas Open Meetings Act, notice is hereby given that the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, in accordance with Article 5, Section 12 of the Charter of the City, will convene a workshop, a special meeting, and executive session on Wednesday, July 1st, 2015, at 5:40 p.m. and 6 p.m. in the Commission Chambers on the second floor of the Brownsville City Hall, Old Federal Building, located at 1001 East Elizabeth Street, Brownsville, Texas, 78520. Workshop. Discussion regarding Phase 2 of the Small Area Plan by Jacobs Group.
Good evening, Mayor, Commissioners. I'd like to introduce Oscar Garcia with Jacobs Group, who's going to give a little bit information for Phase 2 of the Small Area Plan. The City of Brownsville, we're supportive. We're going to have staff work very closely with them throughout the process. And so we wanted to give the opportunity to City Commission to get a little bit more information on how that's going to be done.
Mr. Mayor, Commissioners, how are you all this afternoon? We're going to kick this off.
Yeah. Where do we point? Here.
So Mayor, Commissioners, thank you for this time. Quickly want to go over the Small Area Plan. The Small Area Plan itself really guides local infrastructure development to make Brownsville more competitive globally and helps us connect to changing supply chains. I think it's really important to highlight that Brownsville kind of has a real unique opportunity here. We have five economic ports, essentially. We have rail, truck, air, sea, and a new one coming in, obviously, space. Recent shifts in the global supply chains have created great job creation opportunities for Brownsville. And we're kind of in a great position to become a regional hub of manufacturing production and distribution. As a community, we must make sure that we're prepared to meet these opportunities head on. So I think it's real critical for us to really understand both the need for this type of infrastructure planning and also the opportunity that allows us to capture. So we took a pretty straightforward approach to the presentation: problem, cause, solution. On the problem, we're going to quickly highlight the state of the current economy here locally. We're going to talk about the cause driving some of the challenges we have in the economy, specifically the job clusters. And on the solution, we're going to talk about the role of the infrastructure as far as the role of building a new economy, opportunities to actually create new revenues for city operation, and innovative ways to finance infrastructure without increasing burden on taxpayers. So first slide, real quick, on the problem. One thing that was interesting back in 2013, the U.S. Census came out with their latest stats for MSAs. And out of 366 MSAs ranked from wealthiest to poorest, Brownsville actually came in at 366. That was the Brownsville-Harlingen MSA. McAllen-Edinburgh came in at 364. I think that really highlights that we have a regional issue there. Now, I know we've made a lot of great progress on the foundation of turning this around. Frankly, the leadership from this commission has really put us in a good place moving forward. But I think it's critical to sustain some of these projects going forward. So if that's the visible problem we have, the underlying cause or the root problem that we have is our largest and fastest growing job clusters are in low-wage, low-skill jobs and in non-exporting industries. So a quick look at this graph. The circles represent how much employment are in that cluster. As you can see, predominantly, the larger clusters are the lower wage, lower skill jobs. So moving our community forward, we really need to focus on economic development or job creation on clusters that are high wage, high skill, and export industries. We had previously identified these five clusters to be kind of like the future job clusters moving forward, and that's in the sectors of heavy manufacturing, light manufacturing, logistics, healthcare, and tourism. To be able to successfully grow these moving forward, obviously we need overlapping strategies on education, workforce, infrastructure, economic development, and community development. Again, I think this City Commission has really gone a long way to address key issues on each one of these four areas. This is really about continuing that forward progress. And that was a big part of what the Imagine Brownsville Comprehensive Plan was, to really identify how all these work together to be able to grow these sectors moving forward. So that, with this presentation, we're really going to focus on the infrastructure area. Again, we're going to talk about how infrastructure is a solution that lays the foundation for building our new economy, to grow new revenues for city operation, and really looking at innovative ways of how to finance infrastructure without increasing any burden on local taxpayers. So with that, I'll turn it over to Oscar Garcia with Jacobs.
Thank you, Mike. So as Mike mentioned, the Imagine Brownsville Comprehensive Plan identified these five economic development clusters as our strengths for the area. And so subsequent plans were put forth, small area plans as they're called. In this case, it's the Greater Brownsville Strategic Infrastructure and Land Management Plan. It's a really long title for the smaller area plan that includes the industrial corridor. Focused primarily on those first three economic development clusters: heavy manufacturing, light manufacturing, and logistics. As economic development clusters, right, as a economic engine in and of themselves. However, logistics is also acts, as you all know, as a supporting industry for both heavy and light manufacturing. So we went through a process of developing. There was a collaborative effort between three groups. It was the City of Brownsville, the GBIC, Port of Brownsville, and the Brownsville PUB that came together to produce the small area plan. Jacobs Engineering was brought in to help with the implementation of that effort, because it's a plan just sitting on a shelf does nobody any good. You have to take that plan and actually put it into action, right? So what the small area plan came up with, especially on the infrastructure side, it distilled itself. It's a 500-page document that distilled itself into 32 key strategic projects. Everything from corridor projects to land enhancements to systems to facilities. So transportation layer, enhancements to the airport, enhancements to the Port of Brownsville, all areas. All told, the 32 strategic projects come with a price tag, one that nobody imagines or expects the public sector or the citizens to pick up the tab for. I'm going to go through a quick little scenario. It's a little case study in an effort that went forth about in 2008. And Commissioner Longoria will remember as we've chased this. We've chased several steel mini mill projects. They're recycling mini mill projects. And when the firms looked at us, they looked at Brownsville and they saw, you know, what many firms see. They see we have a deep water port, we have rail, we have land. Plenty of land, undeveloped and unmaster plan, but we had plenty of land. And then we had a proximity to their market, the auto industry and consumer electronics and the like. What we did not have is we did not have sufficient electrical transmission infrastructure. We did not have enough local generated power to be able to support that type of an entity. And the cost of power at that time was higher. And we didn't have the natural gas infrastructure to be able to support that entity. Our competition, unfortunately, had all of those things. And as we had gone through the process, one of the takeaways, and what we lost as a city, was a capital investment in the neighborhood of $2.5 billion, 1,200 jobs, and these are high-wage, high-average jobs, large energy user. So in this case, it was a 250-megawatt user, which is a large power user, which means good money to both our utility as well as to the city, and a large natural gas user. So we really lost out. What we did do as a takeaway from this is we said, okay, so what do we have to do as a community to be able to land a big whale like this? Because this is not a regular small little company. This is a beast, and you really need key strategic infrastructure investments to be able to capture something along these lines. So we looked at some of the different limiting factors that we had. And I'm going to give you another example, a little case study in innovative partnerships. BPUB partnered with Sherryland Utilities to put in 345 kV transmission, electrical transmission. This is, if you can imagine, or you don't have to imagine, but if our electrical infrastructure would come down to Harlingen, come down 77 to Harlingen, go west to the McAllen area, go back up 281, would go west to Laredo and go up 35. So that whole southern portion of Cameron County was always capitated in its ability to grow. So we'd always wondered why we didn't have the ability to grow in and around the port area and in Brownsville area. We had electrical constraints that limited the type of development and be able to land a project like a steel mini mill. A very creative partnership was put forth by Sherrilland Utilities and the BPUB to both justify and get this Cross Valley project type. This is a $300 million project. So in many cases, this was a project that always was limited by, you know, the chicken and the egg, right? We didn't have the customer that needed it, so therefore we never built it. We never had enough money to build it, so we never could land that customer. So it was one of those vicious cycles that we could never get out of. This project came along. We found a partner in Sherrilland that had the deep pockets that could be able to make this happen. And we're going to end up in 2016 with the electrical infrastructure needed to be able to land projects like that at no cost to the ratepayers, which is a big deal, right? Because that was always our big limiting piece to this. We could never get past that. And this innovative partnership made that happen. Another question that was posed early on in the presentation is, how can infrastructure create new revenue for the city? An example, MIA, which is Miami Airport. Miami is one of the busiest airports in the United States. It's number two in the United States. It generates business revenue greater than $33.5 billion. So not only making it a huge contributor to the local economy, but it is the largest economic engine in the state of Florida. Okay, their airport has that impact. Okay. And then we have another example of impact on the logistics side is the Alliance Global Logistics Hub in Fort Worth. This was a Hillwood project. The Perot family took on this project. Fort Worth was always known for the livestock areas. They had an airport that was underperforming, primarily because the livestock grounds were in the area, and the prevailing winds from the livestock area would negate any potential business that could grow in that area. Well, those were closed in the 60s. The Sigma remained. The pros came in there and partnered with the city of Fort Worth and a variety of the other county entities and other public entities to be able to get the airport designated an air cargo airport, and to date, they built that into a global logistics hub that includes corporate centers as well as resident. So to date, they put into about $32 billion, and that logistics hub produces roughly $3 billion per annum to the area in which it operates. So getting back to the small area plan. The small area plan calls for strategic infrastructure, the 32 projects, focused in and around three key projects to the city of Brownsville: the airport, East Loop, and the integrated logistics hub. These are enhancements that are called for in it to be able to convert and expand the capacity of the airport to both grow the expansion of the runway to be able to hold or be able to run additional air cargo business through there, enhancements to the air cargo apron expansion and freight handling, and also air freight connectors into the logistics hub. The East Loop. East Loop is another huge piece to this because it is the connector. It's not only the oversized overweight corridor connector from Veterans Bridge to the south side of the channel, but it connects our new airport. It'll connect the airport. It'll also connects right into the integrated logistics hub. That whole expansion on the south side of Brownsville, if planned correctly and executed correctly, can be a huge boon to the local economy. Huge boon. And finally, the integrated logistics hub. With the roadways coming in, with the enhanced airport, it allows the city of Brownsville. Right now, the city of Brownsville, we have about, as per the small area plan, $8 to $10 billion worth of commerce that flows through this area within the logistics business period, of which the city of Brownsville does not capture much of it. Right, we capture a little bit with truck traffic, as it crosses the Veterans Bridge to the tune of about $2 million. We're not capturing much at the airport. We're catching business, but city's having to subsidize there. The city's not making any money off of the seaport at this point, and not making money off of rail at this point. And so what the small area plan called for is the creation of an integrated logistics hub, similar to what I described earlier in Alliance, Texas, where it takes the enhancements of the airport and brings into this logistics hub an area that allows for development and capture of additional revenue as we move forward into the city of Brownsville. Those additional revenues would be found revenues, right? Those are areas that are not currently generating revenue, whereas with an integrated logistics hub and manufacturing area, this could get us where we want. And finally, the call to action. We came to talk briefly about different pieces, right? We talked about how infrastructure can help you make money, how infrastructure is an important part of changing our economy, helping us move and capture, moving us from a pass-through economy only, where we're normally only garnering low-wage jobs, to an economy that actually is based on exports and innovation. Being able to compete with other communities to be able to capture those jobs. And that infrastructure is really what has always held us back, or the lack of infrastructure is what has held us back traditionally, and this plan really calls for it. And so what we've been asked to do by city staff is to come forward to garner your support as we move forward with this, and that's the end of my presentation. Any questions?
I have a comment to make. I've been labeled as the retail person. That's all I care about, and yes, I do care about that. But I also care about this, and looking at retail is more so just looking for ways, or me trying to look for ways that we can all help generate more revenue for the city. And I love what you're talking about here, because I heard you say billions several times, and retail, that's more in the millions. So I want to get to the billions for the city so we can provide more services to our constituents. So I guess the question or comment is, where do we go from here? How can we get this accomplished?
Well, and that's a great question. What we really are looking for right now is, and city staff asked us to come and present to the commission, because they want to continue to collaborate and participate with other city entities like GBIC, like BPUB, like partners like the Port of Brownsville, to continue to move forward on these projects with the airport, the East Loop, and the integrated logistics hub. And so they were really looking at your all's blessing to help move that effort forward.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Very good, Oscar, thank you so much. Anybody else have any questions?
Let's get some of those billions.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mike, you have about 2 minutes before you open up for a special meeting. Brad, are you giving the invocation? Are you giving? Okay.
We'll do it right now.
Special meeting, 6 p.m., Pledge of Allegiance.
One nation, under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Let's remain standing for the prayer. Father God, once again, we thank you for this nation. We thank you for this state and for this city. Lord, specifically tonight, we thank you for our mayor, Tony Martinez, and we ask you to give him a special anointing for another 4 years as mayor. We thank you for Ricardo Longoria, and we ask you to give him a special anointing for another 4 years as commissioner. We ask you to give all of our commissioners and mayor special wisdom and direction that comes from you. Help them to see what's going on and what your ideas are, what your ideas are for the future of this city. Lead and guide each of us and bring us into harmony. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen.
Mayor, I'll be reading these action items together and then make one motion. Item number one, issuance of certificate of election for Mayor and Commissioner District 1. And item number two, administration of oath for offices for Mayor and Commissioner District 1 and assumptions by duty by elected officials. Motion.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
And Mayor and Commissioners, while we get ready and set up, I would like to just thank my staff for all the meetings we've had and all the time setting up for the election. So I just want to publicly thank them for that.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Michael. That's good.
You.
And then we'll go ahead and move on with the statement of elected office for you, Mayor, first.
All right.
Wait a minute, we'll do your elected statement for elected officer, and then we'll do the I, Antonio Martinez.
I, Antonio Martinez.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I have not directly.
That I have not directly.
Or indirectly paid.
Or indirectly paid.
Offered.
Offered.
Promised to pay.
Promised to pay.
Contributed.
Contributed.
Or promised to contribute.
Or promised to contribute.
Any money or thing of value.
Any money or thing of value.
Or promised any public office.
Or promised any public office.
Or employment.
Or employment.
For the giving.
For the giving.
Or withholding of a vote.
For the holding of a vote.
At the election.
At the election.
At which I was elected.
At which I was elected.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Long time. I had
the honor and the privilege of being a trial lawyer with him. I had the honor and privilege of trying cases with him. And I can tell you there is no quicker mind. He's God. And I also know that from his heart, from his involvement in the community, that every action he takes or every action he recommends is attached to a greater good of our community. The people of this community have sought fit to re-elect him to this position for a reason, because he's demonstrated forward thinking, and that's also an important, very important aspect of public service, that you have the ability to see forward, the forest through the trees, as they say, because the future is coming. We're at a crossroads. Everybody that is in public service right now, whether you're in the audience or up there, knows that we are confronted with some issues that can benefit this public, our community, for the better, and handling in the right hands, the stewardship of that decision, I could find no better man. Tony Martinez, you ready, sir?
I'm ready.
Repeat after me, sir. I, Antonio Martinez.
I, Antonio Martinez.
Do solemnly affirm that I will faithfully execute.
Do solemnly affirm that I will faithfully execute.
The duties as mayor of the city of Brownsville, Cameron County.
The duties of mayor of the city of Brownsville, Cameron County.
Of the state of Texas.
The state of Texas.
And will to the best of my ability.
And will to the best of my ability.
Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution.
Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution.
And laws of the United States and of this state.
Laws of the United States and this state.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Mayor. Thank you for the honor.
Take the photo off. Can I take this off
of you? Yeah, sure. No problem. I think they let me borrow. Okay. There you go.
Okay. It's a great day, and I want to personally thank each and every one of you for being here tonight. It's kind of moving. We've been through a long process this past year, this whole family, which tonight I'm wearing Father TJ's tie. And we're going to dedicate these next 4 years to him, to do the best that we can for all of you. So thank you very much.
Ricardo Longoria Jr.
Do solemnly affirm
that I have not directly or indirectly paid Offered.
Promised to pay.
Contributed.
Or promised to contribute.
Any money.
Or thing of value.
Or promised any public office.
Or employment.
For the giving.
Or withholding of a vote.
At the election.
At which I was elected.
So help me God.
I'll just say a few more words about Rick. As I said, he was part of that program where Mayor Martinez and himself were honored by the students as youth ambassadors, as role models. You know, everybody quotes Emiliano Zapata. He says, "I'd rather die on my feet than live on my knees," right? That's a famous quote that goes around. But he also said something else that is insightful and I think relevant in this case. He also said, "I'd rather live as a slave to principles than to men." And that's important because I think Mr. Longoria here, when he was honored, you know, it became very apparent that he has invested tremendously time, effort, talent, toil, labor, what have you, in improving the lot of his neighborhood, Southmost area. He's a one-man team, can't do it by himself, but he's done the best he can with the ability he has. And, you know, you go to Southmost and you see some testaments to his efforts. The public library out there. But that is part of what I was talking about, public service. That no matter what the issues come, if you're guided by the fact that you're going to make a decision that's going to benefit the greater good of this city that we love so much, this city that we have invested our lives and we raise our children and our grandchildren and what have you, we know that we need people like the mayor, like this commission, like Rick, that are forward thinking, they open their minds, inclusive, open to disagreements, because the best results come when you actually partake and when you actually have a discourse that involves differences of opinions to arrive at a mutual decision as to what is the best for the community. And in this case, Rick has engaged in that, Mayor Martinez and all the commission. I haven't been into their executive discussions, but I'm sure they're elaborate and their disagreements, as there should be. We're all individuals, we have our own minds. You see black, I mean you see white, but then somebody just says, "What about gray?" And there comes the agreement. So anyway, without having said more, are you ready for your oath, Mr. Commissioner Longoria?
Thank you.
All right, repeat after me. I, Ricardo Longoria Jr. Do solemnly affirm that I will faithfully execute the duties as Commissioner, District 1 of the City of Brownsville. Do solemnly affirm that I will faithfully execute the duties.
That I will faithfully execute the duties
as Commissioner, District 1 of
as Commissioner, District 1
of the City of Brownsville, Cameron County.
Of the City of Brownsville, Cameron County.
Of the State of Texas. And will to the best of my ability.
Preserve.
Protect.
And defend the Constitution.
And defend the Constitution. And the laws of the United States. And of this state. So help me God. Congratulations, Commissioner. I chopped it up a little bit just to throw you off key.
Thank you, Judge.
You're welcome.
Hey, if you don't mind, I'm going to do my thanks from the top. Thank you. Bless.
Now y'all know why we have such a good group up here, right? Great sense of humor.
Muchas gracias. Antes que nada, muchas gracias a todos, a mi familia. Quiero dar las gracias a Dios. I want to thank God because the last 12 years of service have been interesting. I've been through, thank God Mayor's here again. And this is my fifth, if you want to go by terms. And the different city commissioners that I've served with, it's been an honor serving with everybody, and everybody bringing their distinct qualities and opinions to what the in the way that the city should be led. I promised that I would begin by thanking my father, my cousin Lupita, and my cousin Pedro, who were with me through the election, were with me through the early vote, were with me on the runoff, and never missed a day. We're always there. Thank you for taking care of the polls. Thank you for taking care of everything that needed to be taken care of, because without your efforts, I don't know where I would have been. So thank you for everything that you did. Thank you. Of course, to my daughter, Franca, who is my inspiration in everything that I do, and my mother, and my brother, and my sisters. I want to congratulate my mom on her retirement from BISD also. Congratulations, Mom. To my friends, to the elected, everybody from District 1, the voters, to my boss, Norma Garcia, to the Brownsville Police Officers Association for their unending support. Thank you to them. I want to thank my buddies who, although we went through a difficult decision where somebody would have turned their back on you, you guys, you know who I'm talking about. You guys came forward and you guys made sure that I pulled through during the runoff. And I want to thank you, not only for your financial support, but for your emotional support in helping me get through it, and my gals. Thank you for everything. To Judge Juan Magallanes, where do you go? Right here.
I've known
Judge for about 15, 16 years now. And I'm not afraid to say it, that when I believe in somebody and somebody that has conviction for our community, I go out. I go out for them and I don't think twice. And I know that sometimes when you support an elected official or somebody that's running for office, it comes with repercussions. But when you believe in somebody, you don't look back. You don't think twice. And that's what friendship and that's what loyalty is all about. So thank you, brother. And of course, to Sophie and Patty, thank you for all your support. Together, we've made a wonderful team over the last 10 years. And man, have we worked for our community. We're the few elected officials that people have actually allowed to give a tax increase, but for the betterment of a community. And we lowered it. We didn't just give it, we lowered it. But thanks to your work, and my work, and all of our work together, we've been able to help our community. Thank you. Thank you, Gavino. I saw Gavino somewhere around here also. I'm almost done. We have a lot of exciting things coming up in the city, and I'm excited to work with this young group of people that we have that have gotten elected, and as well as those of us that have served here for a while. No, I'm not going to go there. Those of us that have served here for a while. I always tell people that I'm the you're part of the commission, and I said, well, I said, if you put terms to it, I'm the viejito on the council. I said, but with that comes responsibility to go into the future and to be able to serve as an advisor, to be able to provide the history for decisions that need to be made. And I'm honored that the people of District 1 and the people of the city have allowed me to continue to serve and to finish this. I'm very saddened by the retirement of my friend Larry Brown. I want to wish you the best, congratulate you, and Mary. When I came in in 2003, Larry, Pete, Charlie, you all took me under your wing, and you educated me in 3 months as to what service was about and the job that I needed to perform, and I want to thank you for that. And Larry, I'm saddened by your retirement, but I'm also happy for you that you and Mary are going to have wonderful days ahead of you, my friend. Congratulations, and thank you. Thank you for everything you've done. If you start putting names to our staff, to everybody that does everything that makes this city function, that makes us look good, you'll never end. But I want to take this opportunity to thank all our employees, a todos nuestros empleados, all the way from Public Works and the landfill, to our offices, to everybody that makes this city function. Thank you for everything that you do. And I'm going to end on a note thanking you, my friend, for your friendship, for your guidance, for always sticking there with me, and always being there. We agree, we disagree, but I'm proud to stand by your side, and I'm proud to be here and continue to serve. And thank you, my friend. Thank you. Thank you.
Michael?
A motion to move to executive session.
Motion to move to executive session.
Second. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Thank you all for being here.
Actions on items discussed in executive session. Consideration and action on resolution number 2015-55 to authorize a review of the Texas Gas Service Company cost of service adjustment COSA tariff, approving a joint review of TGS application along other cities served by TGS, hiring legal and consulting services to negotiate with company and direct any necessary litigation and appeals requiring TGS to reimburse all reasonable costs associated with city's efforts in this rate making effort. Finding the meeting at which this resolution is passed is open to the public and required by law, requiring notice of the resolution, TGS, and legal counsel.
Action item.
Mr. Mayor, I move we allow or authorize legal to enter, or what was it?
Proceed as advised.
Yes, to proceed as advised in executive session.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Motion carries.
Item B, consideration and action on proceeding as advised by council in executive session.
Mark, is that?
That would be the one.
That would be the one. I entertain a motion.
Motion to proceed as advised by legal in executive session.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
And Mr. Mayor, on the next item, I will not need action.
Okay. There's no need for item number C.
Okay, item one, mayor's activity update.
What about D?
What about D?
Item D?
Oh, there was no action on item D. So that's it.
Okay, we've already got the action item that we need. We only had two. One was the gas, and the other one was to follow the advice of council in executive session.
No action on item C.
No action on
C. Okay, so now we have the mayor's activity report?
Yeah, and then D was just for, that's for mayor's activities update.
Okay. Again, just like I'd like to iterate that we've got 4 years to get started to do a bunch of great things. We have a great group of commissioners. I want you all to be sure and participate in trying to help us help you. And we're looking forward to a wonderful 4 years. I'd also like to wish everybody a happy 4th of July. I think we're going to have some activities that someone's going to comment on. I think Larry Yokel, Larry is here.
Mayor, he had to leave, but he would like you to announce the event.
Okay, don't forget, we have our Salute to Freedom on the 4th of July celebration. Fireworks, live music, food and drinks, a Glow Dash 5K. It will be at the sports park. Fireworks to begin after dark or at dark, approximately 6:30. So everybody is invited, and that's have to celebrate our good country's 4th of July. Other than that, I think he asked for
public
it's
comment.
It's a salute to freedom, so I think that's all he was going to say in public comment. So that's all I have.
Item number two.
Sorry.
Item number two, commissioners' activity update.
I have an announcement. last week, Commissioner Gowan and I met with a representative from Walmart, thanking them for their part in this community. I know they've helped a lot with the community gardens effort. And we're celebrating the new Walmart store. And they're still interested in being a part of our community, bringing more of their types of stores to Brownsville. And we also discussed the possibility of them sharing some of the wealth of knowledge and staff that they have in the form of soft skills and hard skills development for our residents. And we talked about them possibly giving back to the community in that way as well. So we're working on that. Hopefully we can offer a seminar to the general public within the next year and offer it for free, well, at the expense of Walmart, but for free for our residents. So that's one thing. And I just wanted to give an update on the country club. San Marcelo has the limestone base on the northbound lanes and will soon be putting curb and gutter. Navarra Street limestone base is only pending on two blocks of the street, and weather permitting should be completed in the next 3 days. Curb and gutter will also begin after that has been completed. And last thing, the PR plan, the rebranding that we have, it's still in the works, and we have some news within the next month or so. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Michelle. Anybody else? Okay. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry. I wanted to invite everybody also to the 4th of July parade that's being sponsored by the Brownsville Herald. It's poorly attended, I must say. It's poorly attended, and usually it's been over in about 20 minutes, and a lot of the kids and a lot of the organizations do come out, and it'd be nice to see the community come out. It's going on Saturday at 9 a.m. down the Charles Days Parade route. It's going to start on 4th Street, and it comes all the way down Elizabeth. So if you can make some time, I'll be over at the Charades headquarters. I MC it for them every year. And if you want to come by, please show your support, you know, not just for our veterans, but for everybody that makes the time to go out and celebrate the freedom of our country. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
And I want to thank staff and everyone for enjoying the Ciclovia at Cadler Park. I don't have the final numbers, but there were quite a few people there, and it was very lively. I'm not sure I've seen Cadler Park that full for a long time. It was a great afternoon, even though it was hot. So we're taking July off, but we'll be back with another Ciclovia in August. So stay tuned.
And just to supplement that a little bit, I was very pleased with all the neighborhoods around Cadler Park. They were wonderful. They were wonderful neighbors. They cooked out. They fed some of our law enforcement officers. Although I told them they couldn't drink beer while they were on duty. But other than that, they had some wonderful tacos, and it was a love fest as far as I was concerned, and the neighborhood really participated. So for all of you, I didn't know what to expect, but it was wonderful. So thank you.
Mayor,
That's because it's District 2 and we rock.
Ah, no wonder. Okay. District 2 rocks. Okay. Next one, proclamations.
Proclamations. Gladys Porter, Early College High School, Estudiantina de Napa.
Last commission meeting, we celebrated the All-America City designation, the one-year anniversary of that, and the group that was probably the most important and the most hardworking of the All-America City team was the Porter High School Estudiantina. They were our background music, basically. They made us sound and look really, really good, and we wanted to recognize them. They weren't here at the last meeting, so we are giving them a proclamation of their own because they are very well deserving. They really put in the long hours, the hard work and effort, and they were very professional. They represented us very, very well. So we would like to thank them for that. So a proclamation of the City Commission of Brownsville, Texas, recognizing the Gladys Porter Early College High School Estudiantina de Napa and helping Brownsville secure the All-America City Award. Whereas during the 2013-2014 school year, 10 members of the Gladys Porter Early College High School Estudiantina de Napa boarded an airplane for the very first time and traveled to Denver, Colorado with a delegation from Brownsville to compete for an All-America City designation. And whereas the members of the Estudiantina de Napa, despite having played together for two previous years, continue to rehearse for countless hours. And whereas Estudiantina de Napa members, under the direction of Eric Huguenot, conducted themselves with great aplomb at all times and were wonderful ambassadors of their school and city. And whereas, when Estudiantina de Napa led the Brownsville delegation into the competition, their entrance was met with wild applause and excitement from the audience and judges. And whereas the All-America City experience opened up the wonder and excitement of a world beyond our beloved Brownsville for the members of Estudiantina de Napa. And whereas the Brownsville delegation agrees that the All-America City Award would not have been possible without the help, cultural color, and vibrancy that Estudiantina de Napa added to the city's presentation. Now, therefore, we, the members of the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, by virtue of the authority vested by the charter of said city, and on the first anniversary of winning the All-America City designation, do hereby recognize, commend, and thank the Gladys Porter Early College High School Estudiantina de Napa on the triumphant role they played to help Brownsville win the 2014 All-America City Award. Done on this, the first day of July 2015, Honorable Mayor Antonio Martinez and City Commission.
It's amazing how time flies. It's already been a year, and it's, you know, we're still talking about it. We're still thinking about it. And I think that's the biggest thing that the students will take with them is that the experience, of course, the memory. I think I can anticipate, and I'm sure 10 years, 20 years from now, they'll still be talking about it, thinking about it. It was a really big deal for them, and it was a big deal for the city of Brownsville as well. It was a fantastic trip, and we thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you.
Item 4, presentations, employee of the month.
Mayor, members of the commission, please help me introduce and invite up our employee of the month for July, Eunice Salinas. Eunice began her career with the city of Brownsville in November of 2009 at the city secretary's office. Learned a lot. Her talents were recognized by our city attorneys, who offered her a position at the legal department. She is recognized as being very resourceful, knowledgeable, has learned to provide legal documents in a very quick manner. I think she was rushed to do so to the mayor and some of the commission not too long ago, and she did it within an hour, broke the record. So we are very grateful for what she does. She has been able to learn a lot of this at the legal department, and save the day is what I'm quoted as Mark saying about her in relation to some of the responsibilities that she's helped with. As Employee of the Month, she is eligible for our Employee of the Year at our banquet in December. She gets the employee pin. Watch, let's make sure it's a girl's watch, yes. The plaque, recognizing her as the Employee of the Month for July. And a few comments from her, thank you.
I just wanna say thank you for this honor, thank you.
I said a few words.
Presentations, Texas Wing Civil Air Patrol.
Commissioners, Mayor, staff, and general public. 15 years ago when I started working with Mr. Brown, when I came into the Civil Air Patrol here in Texas, we had a lot on our plate. Civil Air Patrol, for those of you who don't know, has been a part of the airport since 1941. Started as Coastal Patrol, looking for German submarines and U-boats around the Gulf Coast of the U.S. all the way up to Maine. And Civil Air Patrol's kind of like a little mouse. We had one meeting place here at the airport, then we were moved to this place, and then we went to this place. And every place that we kept getting moved to, it's really hard to build a foundation in a program. Civil Air Patrol, we're all volunteers. None of us get paid for this, and we spend an awful lot of time doing this because we believe in the cadet program, aerospace education, and emergency services, which is mandated by Congress as our three missions. We met with Mr. Brown and said, we need a home. And we were able to finally get a permanent home at the Pan Am building. There was some space available, and we've actually been able to accomplish quite a bit since we took over that space in 2000. And it extends not only for us right here, but all the way to the youth, to the citizens, and to the citizens across the country. Because in that time frame, we've been able to establish a national search and rescue school, be able to train members for search and rescue from around the country that come here every year and do that for a week. We have 100% of our cadets that range from 12 to 21 before they turn senior member, go off to the military or get their college degree. We've had 6 in the last 5 years receive a military appointment to an academy. And we've had kids growing up in Southmost with the love of aviation who become a cadet officer, enlist into the Navy, go in with advanced rank, and actually get his pilot's license at the age of 18 in Civil Air Patrol. He goes on in the Navy, and within 6 years of being in the Navy is the lead NCO, enlisted officer, working for the Navy Blue Angels. First-generation Mexican-American, mom and dad don't speak English, not even U.S. citizens. How can we not think that doesn't change his family tree? And that's why we do this. And without the support of the city of Brownsville and directly from Mr. Brown, none of this would have been possible. So when we put him in for the award back in the fall, we had no idea about what was coming up. We had no idea about his retirement. But he was awarded the Frank G. Brewer Memorial Aerospace Award, Category 3. And I'll read it. To Larry Brown, Brownsville, South Padre Island International Airport. established 31 December 1959, the Brewer Award serve as a memorial to Mr. Frank G. Brewer Sr. for his lifelong interest in aviation, youth, and education. Recognition is given to individuals and organizations that have made outstanding contributions out of selfless devotion to the advancement of youth and aerospace activities. Nominees are evaluated on CAP program support, significance of accomplishments, community involvement, and support of all facets of the aerospace education mission. With Mr. Brown retiring, I see no better time than to present him with this award. Mr. Brown.
Thank you. I think it's important to know, too, what these gentlemen do for anyone who is flying, whether you be in a commercial aircraft, as a passenger, or you're flying your cargo, whatever the case may be. These people are important to your life, okay? If you, God forbid, have any sort of an issue at all, these are the people that can respond and help you with that issue. It's not just important to Brownsville, but what they do is important throughout this whole area and so forth. And so they also deserve a round of applause. Okay. Thank you.
Mayor, can I say something really, really quick?
Please do.
As a child, I grew up across the street from the airport and have always had a tremendous fascination. You know, I never knew what went on behind the scenes, and when I first arrived here in the city, it has been an honor and a privilege to work with you, Mr. Brown. You are one of the most exceptional individuals that has ever worked for the city of Brownsville, and your footprint will never, ever be forgotten. Not that you're going far, because we know how to find Mary to get you, right? But a while ago, you had asked me if I wanted to do the voiceover for the airport, and I told you that I didn't have a voice for it. I think it would be really cool if you could do it. That way, you're never really gone from us, because you meant a lot to all of us.
Be happy to help. No problem.
Thank you.
Thank you guys.
Presentations, VIDA year-end report.
Good evening, Mayor, Commissioners. Thank you for this opportunity to present. It's actually a progress report. We are still in the middle of in the fiscal year. We have one quarter left, but we wanted to give you an update on where we're at so far. My name is Priscilla Alvarez, and I'm the Director of Corporate and Educational Relations at VIDA. I've been with the organization for about 14 years now. For those of you not as familiar with our mission and what it is that we do at VIDA, I'd like to just take a moment to share that with you. VIDA is a nonprofit organization for the last 20 years we've been dedicated and working very hard to address the huge gap that we all know exists between the labor force and employer needs in high growth industries. We were started by Valley Interfaith and local Valley leaders specifically to address two critical long-term issues that plague our Valley. And that is people living in poverty that need training to enter good paying jobs and the shortage of qualified workers here in the Valley. Valley Interfaith believed that if we focused on residents living in poverty and gave them an opportunity to obtain the skills needed and required to meet the needs of our local employers, a few things would happen. Our residents would become self-sufficient, local employers would have a better trained workforce, and there would be an increase in the recruitment of new investment to our area due to that highly skilled workforce. We do that by providing financial assistance and wraparound services to our participants that are seeking a certificate and or up to an associate's degree. Those programs need to be in a demand occupation that will pay a family-sustaining wage and will provide benefits. At the same time, we provide all of our students with intensive case management services so that we can address their academic and personal challenges. This is the heart of what we do at VITA, the intensive case management component. The population that we serve is a very hard to serve population. Students must commit to meeting with their VITA case manager once a week for an hour. Three times a week, they're in a group setting with their other peers, so that they, because we know what their barriers are already. So they work with their counselor to address those barriers. And once a month, they do a one-on-one private meeting with their counselor so that we can do more probing. During these sessions, their counselors discuss academic progress and the challenges that our students face. They cover topics like test-taking strategies, financial and time management, so that they have a much higher rate of success and are better employees for our employers once they graduate. Our partners here are TSC and UTRGV. We also partner with other organizations such as Workforce to ensure that we don't duplicate services. For example, if one of our students needs childcare assistance, then we send them to Workforce, and if they don't have any CCMS assistance for them, then we can help them with their childcare issues. So you might ask, why is funding VITA important? We all know that economic development is important to our communities. VITA is economic development. I just want to take a moment. We brought some of our students with us. I think you can see them in the yellow. If you would stand up for just a moment. VITA is economic development. These are the students that will take those high-paying, good-paying jobs that our first presenter spoke of, and when he mentioned creating jobs. These are the people that are in training to take those types of jobs. Nationwide human capital is the new buzzword. In order to fuel the growth of our local employers and increase the recruitment of new investment to our area, it's important to develop a highly skilled workforce. And that's where VITA helps your community. Our commitment and your investment and support to assist low-income Valley residents get the skills and training in demand occupations helps them to become economically self-sufficient, which in turn contributes to the economic base in the region so that counties and cities in the Valley can provide greater services and attract further investment by employers. I want to just briefly mention an economic impact study that was just done for us. It had been about 8 years since we had had one done, so we had UTPA do a new one for us that was just completed. It measured the overall impact of VITA on the local economy. The study showed that for every dollar communities like yours across the Valley invest in human capital, they receive back $12.12 in sales tax revenues. That translates to a return on the community's investment of $29.6 million in additional jobs, income taxes, and output in the local economy. I think all of you have a packet, and that economic study is in your packet so that you can read it when you'd like. VITA graduates earn higher salaries after training and as a result begin to spend more money, and that generates sales tax revenue for your community. This fiscal year, with your investment and a benchmark of 55 students, VITA has been able to serve so far 88 students because we've been able to leverage your dollars with other state and federal funding that we have. The average wage thus far, and the fiscal year is not finished, is $32,032. We are able to do that by using your dollars as leverage, as I mentioned. I just wanted to end, I brought one of our students that I'd like for her to just share a little bit of her story with you, because this is really the profile of what we do, of one of the individuals that we help at VITA.
Good afternoon. My name is Margarita Olvera, and I'm a 2013 graduate of Project VITA in Brownsville. I was a single mother of one, and I was working at a call center, relying on government assistance to make ends meet. I wanted to go back to school, and I couldn't afford it. And so I truly felt desperate to go back to school. Then I heard about Project VITA, and I applied and got accepted into the program. I quit my job at the call center to go to school full time so that I could finish my degree in 2 years. They helped me with tuition, books, childcare, and my counselor was always there to guide me and ensure that I continue my studies. In 2013, I graduated with my bachelor's degree from the University of Texas at Brownsville in interdisciplinary studies. I'm now a fourth grade teacher, and I went from earning $14,000 to $44,000 a year. I am truly grateful for the opportunity that VIDA has given me. They were the one chance that I needed to make a change in my life, and so they helped me, and I'm truly appreciative of that.
Congratulations. So again, we just want to say thank you and hope that we can continue to count on the support of the great city of Brownsville. I know you've been a big supporter for many years.
And we want to say thank you to you and to you, young lady. Good luck and keep going, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Item number 5, consent agenda items, items A through J.
Approved.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries.
Public hearings, item number 6, public hearing in action on first reading on ordinance number 235-2015-020-S to allow apartments in General Retail G for Block 5, Block B of Ridgeline Subdivision, Section 1, located near Altinglore Boulevard and Centerline Drive.
Good evening, Mayor, City Commissioners. As you can see on the map projected on the screen, the area shaded in red is the area for the specific use. This specific use was before the Planning and Zoning Commission. Staff did not support based on the comprehensive plan, and the Planning and Zoning Commission denied the application. The applicant appealed the decision, and now it's before you. It needs 5 out of the 7 to get approved.
It's a public hearing. Any comment?
He's the applicant. Okay.
Okay. If not, I'll entertain a motion to close.
Motion to close public
second.
Hearing.
Second. I'll take a second.
Did I rescind that?
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion
aye.
Carries.
So he doesn't have a problem with this project being denied?
I'm sorry, sir?
He has no problem with this project being denied?
He's the builder.
Well,
That's the first, okay.
You have any question for me?
I'd be afraid of us, too. Is somebody raising their hand? Before we close the motion?
Yes, I don't think that the public knows basically what the approval is and what the communication with the person. I would really like to explain.
Mayor, Commissioner, I think there was a second to close the public hearing. Do we have to open it back up?
I'll make a motion to reopen it. Because second. I made the motion.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Motion carries. It will be reopened.
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
Estamos hablando de la orden 235-215-020. Yo represento al inversionista en este proyecto que tenemos y pensamos que la manera en la que podemos tener mayor resultado en la inversión que se piensa hacer ahí es en vivienda. Hicimos un pequeño estudio de mercado y realmente vemos que está muy saturado de locales comerciales. Vemos muchos solos por ahí y por el lado de la vivienda tenemos de hecho ya gente interesada en el desarrollo que pensamos hacer ahí. Es un pequeño desarrollo de townhouses.
La comisión se lo negó, ¿verdad?
Sí.
Entonces, usted y su cliente, el inversionista,
sí,
tienen la opción de venir y la escogieron, de venir con la comisión para que la comisión escuche su plegaria, que es en sí lo que…
Así es.
Lo que gusta. Entonces, tenemos vecinos aquí que quieren saber exactamente qué es lo que está haciendo usted. O sea…
Nosotros queremos hacer unos townhouses pegados a unos departamentos que ya están ahí, que vemos que están todos… pues llenos de personas, Van a ser unos townhouses modernos con los códigos que la ciudad nos pida y este y es en lo que estamos interesados, en sacar el mayor rendimiento de nuestra inversión. Pensamos que en locales comerciales no vamos a tener el éxito que podamos tener en vivienda. Y pues resulta difícil invertir en algo en lo que no vas a tener tu retribución.
Why did the Planning and Zoning Commission, why did they deny it?
Okay. Based on the comprehensive plan adopted by the city, the comprehensive plan also only support areas for retails and light commercial, 4-3, fifth commercial type of retail, like a grocery store, offices, professional offices, but doesn't call for apartments on that area.
And you said there's apartments next door?
Yes, well, there were an existing, there were prior to the approval or the adoption of the comprehensive plan. Yes, there's some right here, and probably in this, no, right here, somewhere in this area.
Habíamos puesto también otras fotografías, no sé por qué no.
We have an aerial.
Y hay otras más. Y también aportamos un dibujo del proyecto. Es un proyecto bonito, moderno.
I can barely see it here. But there's some on this corner, just along the with the bike trail, and also a project of a site with probably 14 units on this area, very close by.
I'd like to know what the young lady in the audience was saying, that there might be some sort of confusion or miscommunication. So based on what you know now, would you be for or against this project?
I would like to see pictures and more information about how the maximum is already saved.
This is, well, okay, this is a specific use. As you can see, this is the facade of the building, and this is the site plan. This is the site plan. This is Alton Glor. You can see it right here.
In the comprehensive planning, is there a certain limit of so much saturation of apartments that is the reason why it was?
No, it just doesn't call for apartments on the Alton Glor, on that portion of Alton Glor.
But it's giving you a specific use.
Yes, they are planning for a specific use.
I remember another area like this within District 2 where somebody wanted to build in this same type of zoning. They wanted to build apartments. And I was told by a previous person that was the director that it was spot zoning and that what I was basically recommending was illegal. I think they even quoted me in the paper for trying to help build these apartments, which I thought was absurd. Would that be the case here? Is that spot zoning or?
Very similar, but spot zoning between retail, medium commercial, yes.
And so, I mean, I specifically remember being criticized for trying to help build the apartments, saying that was like a very, you know, illegal situation. Does that have any legal consequences if we change it?
I don't think illegal much as ill-advised.
Right. Yeah.
The reason it's brought to the commission is because it is not zoned for apartments. There's nothing illegal about you making a decision to approve the project if you so desire.
Which is what I thought the first time, but one of our directors quoted that was no longer director.
Well, he's no longer here, so don't worry about him. But the thing is that there's nothing illegal about decisions you make during the commission meeting.
It was very embarrassing.
This is not the first time this property comes to the commission.
Last time the argument was that you weren't given a specific use. It wasn't you, it was your former director. But the argument back then was, before the plan was initiated, was that the person that wanted to build here didn't give a specific use. Now this gentleman is coming back with a specific use. Now the argument is that it doesn't fall within the plan.
It does not fall under the plan.
I'll be honest with you, Mr. Puga, and I do appreciate the hard work that the PNC does, and I know it's hard to get a quorum sometimes, but our job as city commissioners and councilors is to put vacant land and get properties on them and put money in the tax roll so we don't have to affect the taxpayer and get come to a tax roll. I mean, this is something he is given as a specific use.
You know,
he is going to build.
Commissioner, would you consider, like I said, I'm not confused. I just, you know, we have a comprehensive building plan that, you know, we all kind of agree that was what we needed to do. I would like to get a little bit more history, because, I mean, I don't remember all the things.
This is the old Simmons properties, right?
Mayor.
No, you're confusing this area with the west.
Our planning director is not present. He had to leave. I would recommend that I don't see any public input. There was no one came forth. This young lady is indicating that she would like to speak on this. So I would request we table until we get the
motion to table.
I think that's a good idea.
Bring it back at the next meeting.
Well, it's a public hearing right now.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Motion to close public hearing.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mayor, Commissioner, so the planning department now does a thorough analysis to see if any of these projects coincide with the comprehensive plan. And I think if we table this, then the planning department can come back with that detailed analysis for you so that you can clearly understand
like
and be refreshed
so
on what that is.
Motion to close public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion to table.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Thank you.
And just to be clear, it wasn't a current staff member.
No tenemos junta el resto del mes. No va a haber una segunda junta porque este es el, nomás tenemos una junta. Vamos a volver, le van a notificar, vamos a volver en agosto.
Okay.
Vamos a hablar con staff. Staff nos va, vamos a estudiar varias cosas, pero vuelve en agosto.
Sí, está bien. Okay. Como le digo, ahí enseguida hay unos apartamentos y ya están, o sea, lo que voy a hacer yo es mucho más bonito y hay gente que me está pidiendo esa inversión ahí. La otra, no creo sacarle lo que es. Y esa es la mayor preocupación de mi inversionista y pues cada quien quiere una retribución por su dinero, es lo más importante, pero lo vemos. Muchas gracias.
Muchísimas
por oírme
gracias.
Y
gracias.
Para servirles.
Gracias. Item number 7.
Public hearing in action to authorize the issuance of a new taxicab permit for a 2008 Dodge Caravan to Mr. Raul Gonzalez Barrios, who will be operating for Valley Taxi.
Chief.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. Mr. Gonzalez Barrios has filed an application for a new motor cab permit with Valley Taxi. And he will operate a 2008 Dodge Caravan. All the requirements under the city taxi ordinance have been met. And if approved, the number of permits will increase by one, but still under the maximum number of 125. And he will be using Valley Taxi permit 2407.
Okay.
Public hearing.
Motion to approve?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
I'm sorry. Oh, no. Motion to close public hearing. Sorry. Sorry, Chief.
Second.
Okay. Sorry. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Motion to approve?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Item number 8.
Public comments. We have two. Action items number nine. Consideration action to approve the waiving of fees at the animal shelter on August 15, 2015, between the hours of 11 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. to participate in the Clear the Shelters, formerly known as Empty the Shelter Day.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you, Art.
Thank you. Please allow me to introduce our new BARC supervisor, Nelly Zamora. She comes to us from Palm Valley, and we're already hard at work. And this is one of our first, I believe, great projects that's value-wide. We're going to get a statewide exposure as we go forward in this event, and I want to thank the commission for their support.
Oh, welcome aboard.
Well, it's an honor. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Item number 10.
Consideration action to authorize the filing of an FY 2014 and 2015 grant application with the Federal Transit Administration Section 5310 program, the Elderly Persons and Persons with Disability, for self-certification to use for operating, capital, and preventive maintenance.
Good evening, Mayor and City Commission. As a result of new guidelines and requirements under the program, Section 5310 program, as amended by the Moving Ahead for Progress in the 21st Century Transportation Bill, we're going to be making a presentation for fiscal year 14 and 15 funding requests. Ms. Sarah Dubonsky will be making the presentation. She is our Grants and Outreach Manager.
Thank you, Norma. Good afternoon, Honorable Mayor and City Commissioners. We're going to inform you on the Section 53 program, which is entitled the Elderly Persons and Persons with Disability. This grant program concentrates on enhancing mobility of seniors and individuals with disabilities with public transportation. Brownsville Metro seeks your consideration and action on authorizing us to file as self-certified for fiscal years 2014 and 2015 grant applications with the U.S. Department of Transportation Federal Transit Administration to use for operating, capital, and preventative maintenance. Throughout the history of Section 53 federal grant programs, many changes have been seen since its creation in 1975. The latest amendment has been through the Moving Ahead for Progress in the 21st Century, known as MAP 21. Through these different amendments, it incorporates significant changes in the apportionment of funds and ineligible activities. What kind of funds? Funds are no longer distributed directly to the state and administered exclusively by the federal department. Pursuant to MAP 21, funding is now sub-allocated to large urbanized areas, small urbanized areas, and to the state for rural areas. So funds are available for capital, operating assistance, and preventative maintenance. This program authorizes federal financial assistance in meeting the needs of our elderly and individuals with disabilities in offering transportation services. Federal Transit Administration, known as also FTA, apports these funds appropriated annually based on the administrative formula. Plus, FTA has the principal authority and responsibility in administering Section 5310 programs. Brownsville Metro is a designated recipient for 53 funds allocated to the Brownsville urbanized area. What are the roles? The roles are to administer, manage, coordinate, programming of funds, selection, and overseeing implementation of projects that exceed or perform above and beyond existing services provided by Brownsville Metro. So how did we carry this out? Well, we went ahead and we solicited an outreach for subrecipient proposals. We posted in English and Spanish public notices in the Brownsville Herald, We posted notices and uploaded onto our Brownsville Metro Section 53 Program Management Plan and application to our website. A letter of interest was mailed out to the Valley Association for Independent Living, also known as VAIL. Also, at a regular Transit Advisory Committee meeting, members were informed and introduced to Section 5310 federal grant, and we were able to give a deadline of 30 days, which was May 30th through June 3rd. May 3rd through June 3rd, 2015. No grant applications or applicants were received, and this action has caused Brownsville Metro to self-certify for fiscal year 2014 and 2015 in the Section 53 program. For both fiscal years, Brownsville Metro is requesting partial federal allocation of $269,961. The city's local share will consist of $49,697 with 60 cents, giving us a total project cost of $319,658 with 70 cents. These funds will assist in replacing two paratransit vehicles and to provide preventative maintenance. And we went ahead and we provided a proposed budget, partial funding. The top, it goes through the fiscal year of 2014, allocated federal amount is $162,180. With rolling stock, that is for us to do a procurement of transit vehicle for a paratransit bus, and capital preventative maintenance. And you will see that the federal portion of our rolling stock is at 85%. Local portion will be 15%. So the federal portion is $119,688 with 50 cents. Local portion, $21,121 with 50 cents. And it gives us a total of $140,810. Then we have capital preventative maintenance. This gives us a 80% for the federal portion, which will be $42,491 with 50 cents. Local portion will be $8,498 with 30 cents. And that is at a 20% local portion, giving us a total of $50,989 with 80 cents. So it gives us a total project for fiscal year 2014 of $191,799 with 80 cents. For fiscal year 2015, allocated federal amount is $107,781 with a federal portion for rolling stock at 85% of $62,827,000 with 75 cents. Local portion is $11,087 with 25 cents at a 15%, giving us a grand total of $73,915 with closed, no cents. And then capital preventative maintenance is $44,953,000 with 25 cents at 80%. Local portion is $8,990 with 65 cents, again at a 20%. Giving us a total of $53,943 with 90 cents. So if we look at the grand total allocated amounts for both fiscal years, federal portion is $269,961. The local portion, $49,697,000 with 70 cents. Grand total, $319,658 with 70 cents. So in closing, we seek your consideration and action to authorize Brownsville Metro to file for fiscal years 2014 and 2015 Section 53 formula grant. If you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer them.
If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number 11.
Purchase bids and contracts. Mayor and commissioners, we're removing item number 11 at staff recommendation as
remove. Kay. Okay.
Item number 12, consideration action to award a term contract for the purchase and delivery of uniforms for the Brownsville Parks and Recreation Department.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor and City Commission. We are consideration and action to award term contract for purchase of uniforms for Parks and Recreation Department to the company Lynx. And we went through a competitive bid process and averaged the scores, and based on materials and quality of the services provided and delivery, we came, it was very close, but Lynx was the overall selected company.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Item 13, consideration action to award a term contract for the purchase and delivery of maintenance of body cameras for the Brownsville Police Department.
Mayor, City Commander. Commission, this is an important project. We started this several months ago. We did sealed bids on this one because of the price. Body cameras, I think we all agree, are going to be everywhere. Everybody's doing it. It's going to be, it's going to be mandated anyway. We're just moving it forward like all major cities with body cameras. We like the clarity of it. It is what it is, and it's instantaneous. We formed a committee. It was a diverse committee. Myself included, we had MIS, I mean, all different perspectives, servers, cloud-based, I mean, everybody, we had a lot of arguments. I think the cloud-based pretty much won, and I think that's the sign of the future. And we evaluated numerous companies. The top three, we actually put them on our officers. And we're not talking just one or two. We did large officers, small officers. We evaluated three of the top companies, and we really put them through the test. And Taser came out, they're 2 years ahead of everybody else. They were lucky. Ferguson happened, the issue at Ferguson happened, and obviously that sparked everything off on body cameras. But Taser just happened to be already ready to go. Everybody's getting into the action. First year, we've negotiated a 5-year contract. We're requesting your approval. The first year is $174,120. That's 140 units. That's covered by general fund. We worked that out with the city, worked a deal with the city. They're going to cover first year general fund. Years 2 through 5 would be $124,238.80. That's going to be coming through police budget, our regular maintenance contracts. And again, we anticipate the cloud, a lot of the cost is the cloud-based, the cost for storage. And but with all these companies coming in, the storage prices are going to go down. They're going to go down significantly. And we see that happening very, very soon because everybody's getting into it. Everybody's in action. Everybody. I mean, there are so many companies. I mean, we got a lot of proposals. We really feel we picked the right company. They were just the right place at the right time. They'd already had their, they were in place before this Ferguson came in and all this, and we picked the right company. And it was a diverse team of evaluators, and we agreed. And we're requesting your approval.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries. Item number 14.
Thank you,
Commander.
Consideration action to award a term contract for the purchase and delivery of a traffic paint for the Brownsville Traffic Department.
Mayor and Commissioners, here tonight to renew the contract for the traffic paint, the streets and center line. Was the center supply was the lowest bid for the white and yellow paint, and NS Texas Paints was the second on the red paint. I recommend approval. This will take place on October 1st, this contract.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank
anybody
you.
Anybody opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you, sir.
Number 15.
Boards and commissions, consideration and action to appoint or reappoint 5 members and 2 alternatives to the Building and Standards Commission Board.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the City Commission. The Building Standards Commission Board consists of 5 regular and 2 alternate members. This board addresses any issues regarding abandoned, vacant, substandard structures. Staff recommends for 5 appointees as regular members. They are Albert Garcia, Estelita Bailly, Armando Magallanes, Julian Lopez, and Roy de los Santos. As follows, as alternates is Fabriel Cisneros and Juan Velez. Of course, it's up to the commission for its approval.
Is there a motion?
I'll move to appoint the slate.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Anybody opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Now we don't have a motion to adjourn, Commissioner.
We can't.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.